The 3 o'clock class that met in room 224 of the Coleman Slattery Fine Arts Building was for graduate students. It was a small group of four people, plus the instructor, Suzanne Davies Darling. The class was Advanced Sculptural Elements. Before her students arrived, Ms. Davies Darling noticed this thing in one of the garbage cans. At first glance, it was perfectly hideous and belonged exactly where she'd found it. It was impossible to say what it was or what it had been intended to be, and for this reason it caught her attention. She knew perfectly well that it was some rejected student project. That was obvious. But this logical explanation did not concern her. To her, the thing in the garbage can was something else entirely. She felt like someone who has accidentally discovered a baby in a dumpster. It was brightly colored. The paint was still wet, and other things in the garbage can were stuck to it. Paper scraps, orange peel, a soda can, plastic snack bags, beads, and glitter. She did not touch it. She did not want to disturb it until the paint had dried. As far as she was concerned, it was still in the process of becoming. Very carefully, she lifted the garbage can by its handles and lugged it out of room 224, down the hall, up the stairs to the third floor, and into her office. Miss Davies Darling carted the garbage can back down to room 224, on Saturday morning, when the Coleman Slattery Fine Arts Building was partially deserted, Miss Davies Darling carried the garbage can back down to room 224 and removed the thing inside it. She set it on a table and looked at it for a while. She picked it up, turned it around, set it back down, and looked at it for a while longer. She did this several times, consuming well over an hour in just looking at this thing, whatever it was. She adjusted the orientation of the object on the table and looked at that, then shifted it again. Finally, she decided that she had it the way she liked it, and she knew what she wanted to do with it. She altered the angles of some of the, whatever they were, projections, and frayed the ends of two of the ropes, making them look almost like braids and ponytails. She repainted parts of the thing, keeping her colors bright. Then she mixed up a batch of plaster in a tub. She mixed it very dry so that she could shape it into something that looked more like a natural formation of rock, rather than a flat and level slab of sidewalk. Then, before the plaster could harden, she pushed the thing down into it, stepped back, and nodded her head. Then she clapped her hands, and even danced with glee. Additions after that were minor. The sculpture was complete. Like a lady going out for an evening on the town, it only needed to be accessorized. She added a bracelet she had made and a pair of her earrings. With a tube of red lipstick, she created vivid shapes and graffiti on the plaster rock. 3 weeks later, there was a faculty art exhibit. Judged as best of show was a piece by Suzanne Davies Darling, a sculpture entitled Promethea Ascending. No one knew quite what to make of it, but everyone liked it. Some praised it for its wit and humor. Some called it a remarkable feminist statement. Others insisted that the focus was too narrow, that the piece celebrated the victory of the human spirit, even in a disposable culture. And there were those who said they didn't care what it meant. They liked the way it looked, the form, the colors, the media mix. It was not just an award winner, it was also a conversation piece. People who saw it seemed compelled to make some kind of response. Kim, a commuter who lived near the university, came to the art show. She had passed her course with a C and was interested to see what Ms. Dillard would exhibit. Kim hoped it was something cute. When the crowd around the sculpture thinned out, she walked over to take a look. She was marveling at it when another person came up beside her to look. It was Louise. She had gotten a 2-week extension of her Principles of Design course and had just completed the final assignment. She had done it again. She would pass the course and graduate with her class. Kim and Louise did not know each other, except in passing. Kim was a sophomore and Louise was a senior. Intimidated by the presence of an upperclassman, Kim remained silent, waiting for Louise to speak. Louise felt she should say something, but she didn't know what it would be. She didn't know what to make of the sculpture, except that it looked familiar in some way. It sort of looked like a tropical bird covered with garbage stuck in a rock. Louise thought it might be some kind of environmental piece, but she wasn't sure enough to mention it out loud. She looked at the title. That was often a good clue, but not in this case. She had no idea what the title meant. Finally, she said, "Isn't that original?" Kim nodded her head. "It certainly is," she said, her voice filled with admiration. "It's so original and creative." "It is," said Louise. "This is the kind of stuff I'd like to do." "I know it," said Kim, smiling, "but I can never come up with ideas like that." "Yeah, you have to wonder where she ever got the idea for this," said Louise, shaking her head. "I'm not even sure I know what the idea is," said Kim. "Well," said Louise, "maybe she didn't either. Sometimes, you know, you just have to go with it and hope it works out." "I guess," said Kim, still doubtful. "You don't have to know what you're doing. That's what I think," said Louise. "You just have to do it, then let everybody else figure it out." "Oh," said Kim, looking at Louise with increasing respect. Nodding her head at the sculpture, Louise said, "It takes balls." "Maybe it comes with time," said Louise. "Time and experience," said Kim. "Time and experience," said Louise. "And balls."